Okay, good morning. So today we are going to talk about the crop wild relatives and the gene pool. This is one of the important thing which is needed for the phylogeny analysis and also many of the understanding on the crop relatives when you work when you construct the phylogeny tree or interrupt on the how to correlate the wild and the cultivated types. So for that, it will give more information on how these crop wild relatives play a major role in case of many of the crops which is being you are going to study. Mostly we have this course, we have most of the discussion today is mostly on the crop, the gene pools, primary, secondary and tertiary gene pools, and also some of the wild relatives of rice, how we are going to correlate this primary, secondary, tertiary gene pool to their relationship. You already know that maybe you are studied in your other undergraduate courses or your school days, the domestication of the crops. So each crops, when you study the crop relative, you have to study the where the crops came from, and really those crops which are originated in a particular place, still they have the wild relatives are there. If it is the wild relatives are there, whether they have the, what kind of gene pool it came, it is a primary, secondary or tertiary. If you have this information, it is easy to handle the crops in terms of improvement, and also if you want to if you build a relationship between these varieties, land races and wild type, it is easy for your understanding. So for example, if you look on the rice, it is the mostly two center of origin. One is a Chinese center of origin, and India also one of the center of origin in case of rice, and around 8000 BC before it originated. Same way you can see there are a lot of potatoes which came from Peru, South America, some South American continent, and also we got cotton, yam and sweet potato. These are all around 5000-6000 BC, which is was there, which was originally there in the South American, again in the Brazil. If you see Mexico, it's maize came from Mexico, and also you can see many of the millets like sorghum, pearl millet, some of the African rice which are comes from Central Africa. And there are some many of our foxtail millet and some rice which are also have Indian origin. And wheat, when you talk, it is again Mesopotamian region, that is Iran, Iraq, and Syria. And similarly, yam, which comes from Papua New Guinea, is nearby Australia. So like that, you can see every crop which is originated in some places. Those center of origin, when you go to a particular place, you can see still there are wild relatives still in the field. In the mountain or the field, you can see a lot of wild relatives still it is surviving. But international centers and national centers, they collected those germplasms and they deposited in the repository for their maintenance. Because due to the monoculture of varieties, some of the crops which are cultivated, the major cereals like rice, maize, wheat, these are all the things which occupied major area in the world. So if the, because of that, some of them are eroded. So the people collected earlier and they stored in their gene banks. If you talk on these kind of crops, you should look on the what kind of wild relatives are there. So when you talk on the crop wild relatives, CWR, this may be defined as a wild species that are more or less closely related to the particular crop. When you talk on any wild relatives, it's more or less related to the crop. And also you can, also another information, the important things, which always contribute for the genetic material for the improvement of the particular crops for a particular variety. And also this crop species have been, some of them may be domesticated, but most of the crop relatives, some species is helped for domestication of cultivated crops. Some species, wild species, which is entirely very close related, but it may not contribute for domestication of particular species. For example, Oryza Bharti, Oryza Glabrima, these are all the things which are very close related to present day cultivated types. Okay, so when you talk on the crop wild relatives, then gene ecological, which is the extent to which they change the gene with their crop, how they are changing. Then taxonomically, how they are taxonomically related. When they classify taxonomically, whenever you construct any file, and when you study any phylogeny analysis, you should remember that how taxonomically they are related. Just getting a genome sequence and you construct the phylogeny tree, and also if there any problem in the date, in any the problem in the tree, you have to look on that the taxonomical relationship. So taxonomic relationship are built based on the morphological trait, and also these Bentham-Hooker classification, Linnaeus classification, they are classified the taxonomically based on their how they are close related, how they are crossable, and how they are close related. Based on that, based on the fertilization barrier, many things together, they based on the morphological trait, all together they make a species, genus, based on that they classify. So suddenly when you take any genome sequence data, sequence data, when you construct the phylogeny, you have to look on the taxonomy relationship, what then only you can easily validate your tree. So the validation of phylogeny tree is very important. For that you need background informations like taxonomical importance and the wild relatives and what kind of gene pool it belonging, those things you needed. Another thing, you may get up genetic resources, how they traditionally defined the genetic material of known value used for the plant and animal improvement. If the genetic resources means it's a genetic material or leaves known value, it is used for improvement of the plant. The meaning has been widened by the when the conservation convention of biological diversity act comes, GBD been implemented. This every country they have own right to conserve their own genetic material, and CBD is law is introduced. Any material or any materials of plant, animal or microbes or other origin containing functional unit of heredity of actual or potential value. If it is a material, it's have the heredity material, it contains the functional unit, and also it's have potential value, all comes under the this kind of genetic resources. These genetic resources are very important for every country in order to preserve that one and used for the improvement of either crops or animals or other species. So that in that case, the crop wild relatives are key component for any genetic resource conservation according to FAO. So the crop wild relatives, when you talk, they collectively constitute enormous reservoir of genetic variation that can be used in the plant breeding program for developing new varieties. So their challenge, they're providing food security, and also it enhances the sustainable productivity, and also for the rapidly growing populations. So whenever you need more yield or rapid demand on the consumer thing, always people look on these crop wild relatives and gene banks, genetic resources, in order to enhance the genetic potential of the currently cultivated crops or the grown animals. They try to improve that. So for that, it has big potential. So the conservation of biological diversity or the NPPGRs and the international gene banks, they do their job to conserve that and also give continuously materials for the continuous improvement. So they occur in the wild relatives. Normally the crop wild relatives, they occurs in the wide range of habitats, numerous habitats. They have sometimes some of the habitats being lost or some of the habitat being degraded because of natural calamities or because of human occupation or the more population growth, something like that. So that's why the people, they conserved in the in situ gene bank and also ex situ like cryopreservation or the gene banks. So when you talk about the taxonomical and also gene ecological definitions of crop wild relatives, you can see that there are, I already told you, there are three gene pool: primary gene pool, secondary gene pool, and tertiary gene pool. You should know that what is primary, what is secondary, what is tertiary. When I call it as a primary gene pool, it contains close relatives that readily intercross with the crop. If you take rice, if any varieties or any wild types which is easily can able to cross with the present day cultivated varieties, then it comes under the primary gene pool. Whatever the varieties, whatever things, when you make a crosses, you do crossing, it's produce fertile offsprings, it's fine. This is a primary gene pool, even animals also. If it is a crossable and it can able to deliver progeny, it is comes under primary gene pool. What contains a secondary gene pool? This secondary gene pool is the contain the biological species that can be crossed with the crop, but where the hybrids are usually sterile. You can make your crosses between these species which is available in the secondary gene pool. If it is available in the secondary gene pool, you can make crosses between primary and secondary. The crossability possible, but the resultant progeny will be sterile, usually sterile. So for that, if we put some additional techniques, novel techniques to help to regenerate, or we can able to make them to survive, and that has techniques, we have a lot of techniques available that help us to try to retrieve some kind of progenies, so that we call it a secondary gene pool. If we go to tertiary gene pool, it comprises, this is species which are difficult to cross. You cannot transfer the gene from this tertiary gene pool to the primary one. So certain species is available, it is close wild relative or closest relative. But what the problem is, if you have a potential gene available, potential tribe are available, it is very difficult to transfer. That's why there are many of the novel techniques, molecular biology technique, we are applying in order to transfer the gene. If the gene is available in a very important genes are available in the tertiary gene pool, we can transfer to the primary gene by way of many transformation technique. They are the science advancements which major play on the tertiary gene pool. Let us see what are the crops. Any crops you can go. You can able to see a lot of primary, secondary, tertiary gene pool. Already they classified. Already they did a lot of work on that based on their natural hybridization, followed by studying the progenies and how much difficulty it is. So those things already been characterized and people documented a lot of evidences. So in all the crops, you can easily see that this kind of thing. Okay, take example in case of rice. Today is most of the discussion we go on rice. So when you call primary gene pool, you can see Oryza sativa, Oryza nivera, Oryza bharti, Oryza sativa and Oryza nivera. These two comes under primary gene pool. That means these two species, Oryza sativa and nivera, can be easily crossable. And when you talk about the secondary gene pool, here Oryza bharti and Oryza longistaminata, these are very closest wild relative of rice. This can be crossable with this species. So that's why they classified under secondary gene pool. This is the inner circle is primary gene pool, second circle is secondary gene pool, this tertiary and quaternary, that is fourth level. So when you talk on the Oryza bharti and longistaminata and the secondary gene pool, there are a lot of species, non-AA genome. If it is a AA genome, it comes under Oryza sativa, and also this all comes under Oryza sativa primary and secondary gene pool. There are B genome species, there are C genome species, there are E, F, G, H, there are a lot of other genome species available in Oryza. You can see the Oryza genus, you can see all kind of B, C, different kind of genome. It is A is one set of genome, it is diploid, rice, 2N24, it's going into A genome. There are B, C, D, E, G, H, other genomes available. This all comes under the tertiary gene pool, and it is very difficult to make a crosses. If you have any found some type, you cannot transfer directly. So this information, if you know, when you analyze any genome, any sequence data, then if you construct the tree and evaluate the tree, then if you have problem in that tree, then you can look on the taxonomical data and this kind of gene pool data. Then you will get clear interpretation what went wrong and how can we evaluate those things. You can work on that. Similarly, when you look on the wheat, one of the species where you can lot of things available, it is a diploid genome which have A genome, B genome and D genome, A, B, D genome. Normally diploid wheat have either A genome diploid, B genome diploid, D genome diploid. So this is the each diploid. So when you see the bread wheat, it is a hexaploid wheat. It has A genome, B genome and D genome. But again, when you go for primary gene pool, either Triticum tarsi, Triticum tarsidum and Urartu, these are all comes under diploid species, and one tetraploid species comes under the primary gene pool. There are some secondary gene pool available, Triticum timophibi and other AG tetraploid genomes. and sometime R genome diploid genomes, and also E genome and X genome like Cardiomyrinum. And so sickle, these are all comes under tertiary gene pool. So these are all difficult to cross. So like that, the wheat also you have a lot of things you can see. Similarly, cotton, nowadays the cultivated cotton have that tetraploid, this is a primary gene pool, Gossypium hirsutum, diploid, like Gossypium barbadans. These are all comes under primary gene pool. And some of the A genome and D genome and BF genome comes under secondary gene pool. Some of the E genome species, Australian species like C and G, and K genome which comes under tertiary gene pool. So these are all the some example I given you for your this particular course. Mostly on we discuss on rice and cotton and wheat. So every crop when you look on that, you look this angle, how the ploidy of the crop, which is there, or just as we said, diploid. If it is A genome in case of rice, really what are the other genomes which really have crossability, etc. Similarly, cotton like tetraploid, wheat like hexaploid. You have to see which are all the close relatives which contributed for example, cotton have A and D genome. Which A genome, which A D genome species contributed. And during natural doubling, its tetraploid comes here. Okay, so that's why whenever you look on the any kind of species, you look on this gene pool and their wild relatives. So the techniques, okay, now we studied about what are the different kind of gene pool available, what are the difficulty in that primary and secondary tertiary. Okay, if it is easily crossable, no problem. That the people try to cross among the species and they within the gene pool one, they try to make a crosses and derive progenies and they evaluate it and use the markers for marker-assisted breeding, whatever maybe they manipulate easily and working on that. What happened to the, if you want to work on the secondary gene pool and tertiary gene pool? If it is a secondary gene pool, I already told you, it can make crosses and fertilize, but the progeny you will not get. So for that, you already studied in your tissue culture course, the embryo rescue is after fertilization. If the embryo is breaking down or degenerating, then you can go for embryo rescue techniques. That is one of the tissue culture techniques very commonly applied. So you can all, this is one of the technique being followed if the fertilized hybrid is having the degeneration, either maybe due to endosperm or due to the development of embryo, many things may happen. You can rescue the embryo and if you can develop a plant, then you can use it that available genes. Then you can use involving bridge species for the sake. The cultivator directly may not cross with the secondary gene pool. Sometimes if you use another species to make a crosses, then again you make crosses with the secondary gene pool, then sometimes you get a fertile hybrid. So that case, we call it as using bridge hybridization. Use one of the additional species to bridge. Make one crosses with bridge species, then you can make a crosses. That is the one option. Another one is you can use exogenous plant regulators and immunosuppressors or post-pollination stage in order to favor the fertilization, you can use it. Other types you can use also do the backcrossing. If we are able to get some viable hybrids, you can able to make a backcrosses. And also many of the things when you make two diploid species, make a cross and do doubling by chromosomal doubling, you can make a tetraploid type. So that also possible. You can do tetraploid and you can use also hexaploid. This is called a colchicine is the commonly used chemical for developing, making a chromosomal doubling, and then you can make the species survive. Then sometimes you can develop a chromosomal additional line. So you can use as a translocation, alien addition line, alien substitution lines. And this can be done because if you make a cross between one diploid, one tetraploid, if you make a cross with another diploid, then if it is a pairing of chromosomes, possibly if it is close relative, you can add one chromosome. For example, rice, you have 2N24. 12 pair of chromosome. You can make a cross with any other relatives. Then if you had chromosome 1, 2N plus 1, 2N plus 2, something like that, chromosomal additional line you can develop. This is called cytogenetic stop, they call. This can be used for many genetic studies. So that also, you can also develop deletion lines also. So deletion lines, substitution lines, and translocation lines. These are all genetic stocks, they call it as. This can be used to study what is the role of each chromosome? If a particular chromosome, one chromosome is added, like human is trisomy, what kind of things happening in the genetic disorders in the humans, something like that. Plant also, if you add one chromosome, what kind of character is being affected? So like that, the people work on that. So this way, this is chromosomal addition lines, substitution lines all being used. Coming to the rice domestication, we have few slides on the how we are going to see how wild relative and the cultivated are there, how the rice being domesticated. So for example, Oryza sativa is the present day cultivated species. It was domesticated from the wild cross Oryza rubifolgan around 10,000 years ago. So this is the closest relative, and it even it is crossable, Oryza rubifolgan. If you go to the paddy breeding station, you can see this kind of rubifolgan, other wild varieties available. So you can make a crosses. So this is domesticated from Oryza rubifolgan, closest relative, by 10,000 years in the Chinese center of origin. There are two main subspecies in the case of Oryza: Oryza sativa indica, Oryza sativa japonica, Oryza sativa javanica. There are three types, but most commonly used one is tropical region, we have indica type, and temperate regions like China, we have the japonica type. This is Oryza sativa species. In that you have the two subspecies, that is indica and japonica. These two also crossable, but it have most of the japonica are sticky rice, indica are not non-sticky type. Another cultivated type, Oryza glabrima, which is present in the West African region. This is recently the new world rice is grown in West Africa. The West African rice is entirely different. This is Oryza glabrima, which is in West Africa. So that most of the evidences shows that it is the Oryza sativa japonica, which has been in Yangtze river basin in southern China, where the rice is domesticated around 8000 BC. So this key domestication trait is shattering gene, is QSH1, which is fixed around 7000 to 8000 years. Same way, India also have the evidence of 5000 years, we have indica type domesticated. Coming to the Oryza glabrima, this is the African rice, which has been independently domesticated from the Oryza bharti. It is not domesticated from an earlier type, which we've seen, the Oryza rubifolgan, but this Oryza glabrima, which is domesticated from the wild progenitor of Oryza bharti around 3000 years ago. This is the, even though 7000, 8000 years of domestication Asian rice, it is very recent one, 3000 years ago, Oryza bharti being domesticated. So the Oryza glabrima is the first rice cultivated from the Africa, which probably the Portuguese may be introduced from Asian countries, because rice is not native of Africa. Okay, so this is the West African countries, where many of the countries now start growing this kind of rice variety, African rice variety. So this is glabrima type, which is mostly they are cultivating in Africa. A lot of literature you can see in that. So you can see, I already told you, there are a lot of different genome. You can see these are all the species. You can see Oryza sativa, glabrima, rubifolgan, punctata, minuta, and officinalis, and also australiensis, brancheata. So like that, you can see a lot of each species have different types, like grassy type, tall type. So there are genus Oryza, these have A genome, some have tetraploid A and C genome, minuta, and you have the C and D genome, tetraploid type, F genome, F, E genome, C genome, these are diploid types. So you can see a lot of wild types. You can look on the genomes, and also there are more than 5,500 cultivated glabrima sections also available. Okay, let's see the wild and domesticated phenotypes. We can see a lot of wild types have on characters, and many type of character you can observe the wild types. When you visit the paddy breeding station, if you look the plant type, you can see a lot of difference between wild and cultivated types. So this is all some of the open panicle and shattering types, all green color, something you can see there. Okay. When you look on the evolutionary tree, when you look on the Oryza evolutionary tree, when you construct the evolutionary tree in the Oryza, you can see, if I already told you, around 7,000 years in Oryza sativa, subspecies japonica, which has been domesticated from rubifolgan, it is around 7,000 years ago in Yangtze River basin in southern China. same time this, while these are not independent domestication even, it is being simultaneously, you can see both Oryzas Caeva Indica and also Japonica types available around 7,000 years. So this have some kind of diversion between the Japonica and Indica around 5,000 years. We have evidence that Indica types are there, but still there is no proven evidence that exactly which year these two are differentiated. But based on the phylogenetics, there is a difference. So only from 7,000 years, these cultivated types, which are differ from the wild types, like Oryza glabrima, Bharti, and other things. And also similarly, Longistaminata. And so when you look on the, for example, this is Longistaminata, this is the Rubifogan, this is Punctata, this is Officinalis, this is Australiensis, and Brachyantha, and also all these species, when you see that, when you analyze their any of the sequence data or many of the phylogenetry and the domestication will be people studied, you can see how they are diverged, which million years they are diverged, what is the relationship between these things. You can give a lot of literature. This will tell you that how this can be classified as primary and secondary and tertiary center of origin. So one should, we have given so much importance, maybe another five to six minutes we will discuss about why this much of importance is given for this kind of wild genetic resources, crop wild relatives, etc. Because this contributed many kind of tribe to our present day cultivated type. For example, I can say that, for example, nowadays the people working on BPH resistance, and also the we have blast resistance, many things we are working. These are all being introgressed from wild species and now being used for the marker study breeding program. And if you see the bacterial leaf blight, and also Tungro, and also there are iron toxicity, all been introgressed from tetraploid genomes like BC, B and C, C, D, E, F genomes in rice, the BPH and bacterial blight. These are been introduced. And many of the monogenic addition lines and also chromosomal segment substitution lines also developed from these wild relatives. And also, nowadays the people working on C3, C4 pathway, that also been working from wild relatives. And similarly, there are many gene pools which contributed for major biotic and abiotic stresses. And nowadays, you can see hybridized programs which uses the cytoplasmic genic male sterility. So the cytoplasmic incompatibility is from other species like Oryza perennis, other wild species which have incompatible cytoplasm. So that will be used as a potential for developing cytoplasmic genic male sterility. Similarly, there are we already seen that the there are 22 wild species which have tetraploids, diploids, and these wild species show tremendous amount of morphological diversity in terms of plant habit and their shade and partial shade. Some are growing, some of the resistant to biotic abiotics. These are all the things people when you look on the wild rices, you can get a lot of information from that. Similarly, the wild rices, when you look apart from the Oryza sativa, Oryza group, there is also some other wild rices which is available in Canada and USA. That is the closest relative, that is Zizania. So Zizania is the one of the, it's similar to lice rooting. This is, it's almost like present in Canadian region. So this grain is historically gathered North American continent. And this is not directly related to Asian rice, but this Zizania is very close relative one. And also, you can see that Rubifogan, Nivara, which are all been regularly people are using for a crossing program in order to improve their many of the tribe, which is easily crossable one. So the modern varieties, when you go for a traditional varieties, there are a lot of source of genetic diversity which is present. So the wild species I told you they used for crossing program, commonly used one is Rubifogan. This is commonly used. There are many reports are there. During the course of domestication, many genes are lost during the domestication. One gene is I called you onless rice nowadays you are getting, then shattering gene. There are many genes which lost during the course of domestication. So if you want specific gene for resistant gene, again you have to look on the secondary and tertiary gene pool. So these most successful examples in case of Oryza nivera, varieties which is for resistant to grassy stunt virus, and also wild abortive cytoplasm from Spontanea, which is used for hybridized program in case of initially Chinese, they started the hybrid rice program. We started from spontaneum type, which is one of the cytoplasm which is contributed for development of hybrid rice program. So these are all the things which normally give very good information. I already told you there is when you talk about the strategies for the gene transfer from wild species, we can use for genetic variability development and also the alien introgression. And what is a sativa crossed with wild types? You can F1 may be sterile. You can use embryo rescue technique. You can recoup the F1s. Then you can cross with the sativa again to back crosses. Then you can able to transfer some of the genes from other wild types. That is normally that people are doing. So other than if you want to develop a allele triploids or alien addition lines, AA genome plus additionally one chromosome each, you can do that. So there you can develop some of the pyramid, you can add the QTL which is present in the backcross progeny, you can use it. And also the introgress, when you do the introgression, when you transfer the do backcrossing after embryo rescue, you can do the staining, chromosomes can be stained by fish staining. So this staining will help you to the chromosomal preparation when you look on that, which have differential staining, it can able to tell you that from which chromosome, which part of the chromosomes, which is coming from other types by simple karyomorphology study on the chromosome. Many cytologists are working on that. When you have 2N24 rice chromosomes, so when you add 24 plus one chromosome, that means 24 plus two, that means one pair of chromosome, then you can have the lines which have, maybe it may be a partial sterile, but you can rise with one advantages, you can multiply by vegetative, that means you can, every time you can do the retuning and you can able to get the crop live. So by that you can add every line, every chromosome added, 24 chromosome plus two chromosome from other species. So 24 plus two, 24 plus five, four, 24 plus 1, 2, 3 also you can do that. By that you can able to develop monogenic alien addition lines. So that will help you to know if added one first set of chromosome along with the 24 chromosome in rice, then add one more set of chromosome, what kind of effect in the phenotype, you can see what kind of type it is contributing. By that the people are studying now, monosomic, many studies are already available. Addition of monosomic additional line.